Okay, 感谢上一组啊 Dimitris 还有我们的 panel， 就中国和海外贸易商之间最佳租赁合资合作这样的一些商业机遇进行的这个交流和探讨。今天的我们的论坛呢到现在为止谈的基本上都是航运金融或者相关的这一些观点的一些交流。我想接下来这个 panel 可能是会比较有点意思啊。那么这也是Capital Link 这个论坛呢首次引入了这么一个 panel 啊。那么这一次呢我们这个 panel 呢是探讨的是中国海事教育培训对全球航运的重要性。那么在这个 panel 里面呢我们非常高兴的能够邀请到我们中国顶尖的三所海事大学，大连海事大学、上海海事大学，还有集美大学的领导。那么同时呢，参与到我们这一个panel 的还有来自我们境外的几所机构的代表，有来自马来西亚海事学院，来自英国国际海事工程与科技协会，还有我们缅甸的海员培训中心的负责人，那么他们在中心国际海事培训中心执行董事季先生的主持下呢，共同呢就我们中国的海事教育这一个课题呢进行交流啊，请各位嘉宾上场。
Distinguished corporate leaders, CEOs, guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to all of you. This is our second last session, means that we are one step closer to our cocktail. I'm Mikey from Singapore Nantong International Maritime Institute.It is a great honor for me to be able to stand here today as the moderator for this panel discussion on maritime education and training in China. As you can see, I'm not very tall, so hope that our distinguished guests at the back row are still able to see me.I don't speak English. Coming from Singapore, I can only speak Singapore English. We call it Singlish. Hope that all of you can understand my Singlish. Up to this point, I think the forum had discussed intensively on trading, banking, financing,No doubt these are very important issues and resources to the maritime industry. However, I think a quality human capital is an equally, if not more important, resource in the maritime industry. More critically, it is a more difficult resource to cultivate and develop. How productiveAnd valuable the people in the industry can make the difference between success and failure. We used to say a captain of the ship, in fact, is a CEO of the company with a high financial values of cargo the vessel carried. The quality of people in the industry is measured by their productivityand professionalism. Both depend on the maritime education and training they had. That's why I think this evening, this afternoon, the panel discussion on the maritime education and training in China is an important one. To share the insight of the maritime education and training in China,We are honored to have six panelists today with us who are the expert with vast experience in this field. Let me introduce the panelists. First of all, we have Professor Pan Sing Siang, the Vice President of Dalian Maritime University. Professor Xu Xing, the Vice President of Shanghai Maritime University. Mr. David Frederick, CEO of Malaysia Maritime Academy. Another David, Mr. David Kelly, Director Asia Pacific of Institute of Marine Engineering, Science and Technology. Professor Lin Qingpiao, President of Qimei University. And last but not least, Captain Pai Su Ong, Founder and Director of Myanmar Excellence Star Maritime Training Institute in Hungary. With that, let's begin our panel discussion. Perhaps we start with Professor Pan Sing Siang, the Vice President of Dalian Maritime University. Professor Pan, over the past few years, China has intensively initiated many maritime policy aimed at making China a maritime power and close gap with the international shipping industry. What, in your opinion, are the key initiatives Dalian Maritime University have implemented to further enhance the core competency of Chinese seafarers in the international shipping industry? Professor Pan, please.
Hello, 各位嘉宾，我今天用中文跟大家交流，因为我的英文交流起来不能够完全表达我这个意思啊。刚才主持人就问及我们作为大连海事大学这几年怎么来落实关于这个国家这一块的相关的一些个战略，以及和国际化这一块如何来对接啊。首先借此机会，我跟各位代表介绍一下大连海事大学。大连海事大学到现在为止已经有108年的历史，从建校至今一直是属于交通运输部，晚清的时候就叫邮船部，邮船部就相当于现在的交通运输部，建国以后一直是在交通运输部当中。所以今天有一些客人他不太清楚为什么大连海事大学在大连呢，因为大家众所周知，北京没有出海口，北京的这个出海口最近的两个地方，一个天津，一个大连。当初大连海事大学建校的时这个并校的时候，1953年并校的时候，周恩来总理选址选了两个，一个是天津，一个大连。考虑到那个时候我们办学要依赖于要和那个苏联要进行合作，所以就选在了旅大就在大连。那么大连海事大学是1960年被确定为全国首批重点大学，32所工科类的重点大学。1997年被确定为首批29所211重点大学。目前学校一直是在交通运输部的领导下，也是唯一的一所交通运输部的高校，全国重点大学。我们现在交通运输部的部长杨船长亲自分管我们学校。交通运输部一直以来对我们学校给予了极大的支持。我们学校规模应该说是28000人一共有50个专业，一共有7个一级学科博士点，7个博士后流动站，2个国家级工程中心， 这是我们这些年取得的成绩啊，并且近几年我们在海上这块获得的国家奖，我们连续拿了4项啊。那么应该说，在新的航运强国、海运强国的背景下，我们和兄弟的上海海事大学和集美大学和武汉理工大学，我们这些海上的这个运输类的高校肩负起、共同承担起我们海洋强国、海运强国的这种使命。我们学校一直以来非常重视学生的素质的培养啊，我们现在也是国际海事组织确定的世界海事大学第一分校，也是85年被确定的亚太地区啊船员培训中心啊。那么我们一直是非常重视跟踪国际海事动态，我们专门成立了 IMO 中心，代表交通运输部跟踪这个国际海事的相关动态的发展。目前非常注重啊，在绿色航运、高效航运啊、安全航运这方面的一些工作啊，所以使得我们啊航运这一块啊，这个航行更安全啊，这个航行的环境更为清洁啊，航行的这个设备更为高效啊，就肩负着这样的一个使命。那么目前呢，我们学校应该说是啊，在新的这个发展背景下，尤其在目前航运业啊面临的这个寒冬的情况下啊，我们如何积蓄我们的力量啊，在这方面开展相关的一些研究啊，那个并且呢，我们要培养这个相关的人符合啊我们国际海事组织的相关的要求啊啊，就是我先介绍那么多，谢谢各位。
啊，谢谢老师。The next question I have is actually inviting Mr. David Frederick, CEO of Malaysia Maritime Academy. David, from the international perspective, do you think China policy effort thus far to enlarge its pool of Chinese seafarer that they are equal, if not better than their international counterparts, and make progress? What other area should China focus on as an international well-recognized academy that ranks amongst the top 10% of the maritime institute in the world? How would Malaysia Maritime Academy use maritime education and training to sharpen human capital in our industry? David, please.
Thank you, Mikey. Good evening, everybody. Just a bit of background. I have with me 14 years of fleet management experience and about 8 years of human resource experience. So when I took over the academy 6 years ago, I fully understand the need that the industry has. In this day and age, the industry has very, very high demands. The operators, the owners of the ships have a tremendous high expectations of the manpower that we develop. Training to STCW standards is a given. It's a must. But the industry today demands a much higher level of operational excellence, of thinking, of behavior, and the ability to communicate. And that is one thing that we practice and we train at the Maritime Academy in Malaysia. A very holistic approach in developing people to communicate, to understand each other, and to have the competency that is demanded for by the industry. We have been taking in cadets from around the world, and we have about, at any one time, about 1,200 students in our academy. And as I prepared to come here and speak to you all today, I thought one of the best ways to say or to share what we do at the Academy is actually to get one of our top cadets on the Dean's list, who graduated just 2 weeks ago, to come up and say a few words on how the Malaysian Maritime Academy has transformed a Chinese national. So please join me in welcoming Ms. Winnie Gu, who's coming up from the back there, to say a few words on stage. For your information, Ms. Winnie Gu has sailed on at least 3 FMX tankers, and last 2 weeks ago she was Dean's List Award at the Malaysian Maritime Academy, as well as she's one of the cadet leaders during the 3 years that she spent with us.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And my name is Gu Siyi, and I come from Shanghai, China. I'm currently a first officer and serving for AET, American Eagle Tankers. And Alam gives a great opportunity for me to study, and it creates a very comfortable environment for the females like me and also my batchmates to stay there and study there. And there already have been 8 batches of female seafarers who has been graduated from Alam's, and right now they are serving or going to serve on board ships. And Alam is an all English teaching academy, from the lecturers and to the trainers. So all the knowledge that I have learned is in English. And I also joined Toastmasters, which is in Alam, during my studies to improve my communication skills. I have sailed on board 3 crude oil tankers, which are running in U.S. trade. So all the crews on board are all from different countries. And I'm able to communicate with them without any cultural or language barriers. This is because what I have learned in Alam to adapt their different cultures easily. And because Alam is a different cultural academy, which have students from all of the world. And people may ask me why I choose Alam to study. And I would like to say that Alam has an holistic education system with well-equipped facilities to get me ready to serve my ships, whether from theoretic side or from practical side. I would like to thank Alam and Singhai and also American Eagle Tankers to give me this opportunity to serve as a seafarer on board the ships. Thank you.
So just to summarize, Mike, I think there's a huge potential for the young talent from China to dominate the manpower requirements of the seafaring industry. It's just that we need to tap into this potential in the right way. But at the end of the day, the final outcome is for the ship owner to be very happy with the talent that is being developed. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, David. We know that China has the largest pool of seafarers in the world, and is currently the second largest seafarer supplying country in the world, with a lot of untapped potential to provide more seafarer to the international shipping community. Supported by the Chinese government, One Belt, One Road initiative to revive China as a strong maritime nation. I would like to invite Professor Su Xing. Do you think building up and supplying a large pool of high-quality Chinese seafarers is an important step in the right direction? Could you also share with us what Shanghai Maritime University has done so far to support the China government One Belt, One Road initiative? Professor Su, please.
好，各位嘉宾啊， 非常高兴能够来参加今天的这个论坛。我觉得这次论坛专门安排了一个单元来讨论海员人才培养的问题，是非常非常必要的。那么在回答我们主持人刚才的这个提问之前呢，我想简单的先谈一下对我们海事类的院校关于人才培养所面临的形势谈点理解，可以归纳为这么几个方面。一个，从需求方面来讲，受国际低迷的航运市场的影响，世界海员的需求处于一个疲软的态势，是一个不争的现实。第二个，从技术需求的层面来看，在全球新一轮科技革命的带动下，我们全球的航运技术正围绕着低碳、智能和安全等方面的主题正在不断的推进。更重要的一点，对于中国本土的涉海类的高等院校来讲，习近平总书记所提出的共建海上丝绸之路的重大创意，是我们这些院校目前所面临的一个重大的历史使命。那么基于对目前形势的这么样几点理解，这里呢，我想结合主持人刚才所谈的问题，着重介绍一下目前上海海事大学在培养高质量高水平的海员方面所做的一些探索。首先，第一个方面，我们比较侧重于海员人才培养模式的创新，主要是围绕着通识教育、专业教育和个性化培养三个环节，来提升我们上海海事大学所培养的海员人才的素质。具体来讲，在通识教育方面，我们有这样的一个理念：海员的培养首先是人的培养，其次是专业素质的培养。所以我们在通识教育当中非常注重我们的学生语言应用能力的提高和职业素养的培养。在近期我们进行的教学改革当中，我们的学生所接受的语言的训练和人文素养的熏陶将明显的得到加强。关于我们的海员学员的专业素质的培养，我们将积极的对接 STCW 等公约的要求，把握刚才我所讲的全球的海事技术的进步，不断的更新我们的教学方案。第三个，在个性化培养方面，我们将加强和业界的联系，针对大型船、特种船、智能船的船舶的操纵的要求，来增加学生学习的相关的内容。第二个方面，就是我们想结合我们刚才主持人所提及的一带一路的这个实施，在这个方面，我们顺应一带一路战略的实施的要求，建立了一系列专门的教育培训机构，来为丝路沿线各国提供相关的教育和培训。在这个方面，我们近年来获得了上海市政府的长期稳定的支持，为我们沿线的国家提供相关的专业培训，涉及的区域包括印度尼西亚、马来西亚等各个国家。同时，今年上半年 世界海事组织授权上海海事大学在上海正式成立世界海事组织亚洲技术合作中心。我们愿意集结相关的资源，为一带一路的实施，为全球海事领域的教育培训活动做出我们应有的贡献。时间关系，简单说这些，谢谢大家。
谢谢。Thank you. We know that the Institute of Marine Engineering, Science and Technology is a respected non-governmental organization promoting scientific development of marine engineering, science and technologies. There are worldwide memberships based on over 120 countries. I would like to invite Mr. David Kelly, Director Asia-Pacific of Institute of Marine Engineering, Science and Technology to share with us what initiative the Institute has to attract and nurture young and energetic marine engineering, science and technology talents in China. Mr. David Kelly, please.
Thank you. Well, as the introduction says, we've got members in over 120 countries around the globe, 21,000 members and globally. And obviously, one of the key things from our perspective as a global charity is supporting the next generation of seafarers that come through the industry, because they are the next leaders of our industry. So inspiring them to get into the sector and to see those opportunities available to them are really important. We basically put a scheme in place called See Your Future, and the pun is definitely intended there, basically to attract, retain, inspire, engage and develop the next generation of seafarers. But the first thing we had to do was to look at the sector. We were doing a lot of work with a lot of our marine partners, a lot of other shipping companies in the sector, to work out what they want from the next generation of seafarers, how the industry is changing, and the value that the IMRS can provide to them. So the first step was to put into place a career framework that basically mapped certificates of competency to levels of professional membership and professional registration. The importance of that was that for any engineer that was going through that's in the shipping sector, typically under the Engineering Council's standards, you had to have a master's degree qualification to become chartered. Now, we all know that for a seafarer, having an undergraduate degree and certainly a master's degree is quite unlikely. So a lot of work that we've been doing in the meantime has been mapping the competencies that have been required for the different levels for those that are sailing at sea to different levels of registration, and we've basically mapped out that process. Part of that consultation with industry highlighted some really interesting things. The Institute is all about professional development. It's all about developing individuals, developing themselves, harnessing their leadership skills. And 93% of the companies that we talked to said that they did invest in and support professional development of their seafarers, which is a good thing. But 46% of them said that the cadets that were coming into their shipping companies, only 46% were considered as being oven ready. So we realised that with the amount of opportunity to support the next generation of cadets coming into the industry, we had to do something to support them. So we put in a programme to provide free membership to any studying student and cadet, support them through their studies, and put them on a decent career path whilst they're at sea. To support them, another initiative that's sort of accumulated over the last couple of years was the IMRS purchased part of Plymouth University in the UK. It was part of the university called the Hydrographic Academy, and what they were doing was offering blended distance learning degrees online. And we recognised that for seafarers that typically a lifetime career at sea is not the usual route. Providing an opportunity for them to do some learning whilst they're at sea or whilst they have their downtime ashore was important. So we've got a number of programmes to support seafarers, to support their education, to support their training, to provide mentors for them, to provide the opportunities for those the opportunities for jobs ashore, and provide a global network where they can talk to a global network of members and share their problems and share their opportunities going forward.
Thank you very much, David Kelly. The next questions I have is Professor Li Qingbiao, President of Jiumei University. We would like to invite Professor Li to share with us what initiative Jiumei University has implemented so far to support the China government One Belt, One Road initiative, and whether other maritime and education approach is needed for Chinese seafarer. Professor Li, please.
好，非常感谢，会主办方邀请我来参加这样一个论坛。然后呢，我到加入到这个行业，应该搞不好是在座的最年轻的，因为我刚刚从另外一个大学调到集美大学来当校长，只有2个多月的时间。然后呢，这2个多月实际上我见的我们集美大学的校友大部分是航海人，在各个码头。 所以我经常讲，我到处拜码头。今天我依然到我们这个论坛来拜我们这个论坛的码头。那关于集美大学，刚才那个主持人要求我介绍一下。我们集美大学是在厦门，大家知道厦门是个非常美丽的城市，也很宜居，也很好的名声。集美大学现在有26,000个学生，加上我们有一个独立学院，成毅学院，实际上10,000多学生，所以我们有40,000多的 本科生。那集美大学是这么一个大学，它原来是由著名的华侨陈嘉庚创办的，在1918年创办的，从师范开始，1920年创办的航海类的，跟那个水产跟商科类的。所以呢，从明年就是如果按我们集美大学的那个校龄来讲，明年就是100周年的校庆，也欢迎在座的各位有机会或者乐意的话。 到时候100周年校庆了，到我们学校一起来热闹热闹。第二个就从航海这个学科的教育来讲，是从2019-20年开始。那我们那个这个学校是不到20年前，我们合并成一个大学，是由5个学校合并的，一个就是航海，一个就是水产。水产学院实际上就是原来叫上海水产学，后来到厦门叫厦门水产学。后来那一部分的人就搬回到 水产学院的一部分人搬回到那个上海以后，现在就中国那个上海海洋大学，所以这个我们是同源的，这些。然后呢，我们还有一个那个厦门那个集美那个财经学院，所以那个财经学院现在在我们业界财经实际上还是有相当的影响力。还有我们一个体育学院，体育学院在今年的春晚的会面有一个武术表演。 上面有8个世界冠军是毕业集美大学，我们还有师范学，也就是我们这个学校呢是由航海、水产、财经、体育还有师范，所以呢是一个更比较综合一点的一类大学。那我们的文科类、艺术类，还有电子信息、理学理科的这一部分呢，是由原来师范类跟相关拓展出来，所以我们应该想更倾向是一个比较综合类的一种大学。但是呢，在这一类大学里面，航海 跟涉海这2个是我们学校办学的一个特色或者基调，我们一定会保持下去。我们现在有了涉海专业，大概有14个，那直接在海上的专业大概有5个、6个这么一种比例。每年招生就是海上直接就走船的这部分的专业学生是超过1,000人，因为我们跟交通部也有一个共建的协议，他们要求我们不要少于一定的数目，为了保证国家。然后呢，我新上任之后， 我也跟交通部、跟海洋国家海洋局承诺，我一定会加大海洋学科、涉海学科的人才培养的投入，不会减少。因为在座都知道，涉海专业的投入，那个办学花钱是比较多的。 啊，而且还会带来很多很多困难。那我们学校现在在那个涉海专业里面，我们还有一艘6.2万吨的啊实习船，大概可以接收同时一批的学生，大概是啊有几百个、上千个学生可以不定期来实习的。这是景美大学大致的一些情况。第二呢，我跟大家报告一下我对航海的人的认识。正好因为我是厦门人，所以我在高中毕业的时候，我有一大批同学在考大学的时候，哪怕能够上本一的大学，都选择了当时考景美航海。好，所以在这种情况下呢，我就发现，然后在现在我见了这么多航海毕业的学生的话，我发现他们非常团结，非常勇敢啊，非常的有见识啊，等等，很抱团啊。我们走到哪，只要一说航海的，他都很抱团。甚至我们在上海的那个景美航海校友会有自己的房子啊，可以接待各地来的这些校友，所以我觉得这非常好。但是呢，我村子有一个比我高一届，当时考上航海的，后来自杀了。我自己的几个同学考上航海的，有的还在走船，有的现在已经上岸了。我大概统计下来，一半对一半。什么叫一半对一半呢？就是有一半走船走久以后，我们一般的人会认为他性格有点问题，甚至我们可能讲的不太对，在座的也许不太对路，可能觉得心理有点问题。所以我就在思考这个问题。那我们办了航海，我们如果把好好的一个人，最后大家经过工作到一个思想思维方式出了偏差，那我们的教育是不是也出了问题？所以我一直我开始就因为我们村子正好有这些问题，所以我有这么一相关的人，所以我就讲第三，我要说对航海教育的一些认识。刚才正好我们那个主持人要求我觉得我自己非常肤浅的接触这种航海的教育，但是我觉得有几个。第一，他很不一样的地方就是他的工作环境，他将来一旦上船去工作了，他的工作环境一定是跟在陆地不太一样的。你再大的船，它的空间还是有限的，就是航母啊，就是什么船，这是一个。第二呢，互联网条件下，现代技术发展条件下，今后是不是有无人驾驶的船只，现在无人驾驶的高铁、动车、汽车，这些将来怎么办？互联网条件下什么意思呢？啊，在现在这种小孩子这种从小就互联网习惯的话怎么样？所以呢，我们面临的一个招生，比如我问在座的各位，你们如果都是曾经是走船的人，你们会让你们的孩子再去走船吗？这是个非常现实的问题。当你的经济社会发展到一定的成熟程度的时候，那些真正热爱航海、真正这一部分的人到哪去寻找，到哪去引导？这是我今天面临，也就造成。所以我觉得就工作环境来讲，我是给在座的各位船东、各位老板、作为这一个业界的这些前辈们建议，就如何我们今天有了这么一个目标要去发展，哎，必须发展航运行。那好，它的环境如何去改善？啊，如何共同地做好宣传？啊，比如说，我一直在想，能不能我们这么一种论坛，或者我们有某些基金会，今天能够投入更多，来让这些年轻的孩子们能真正认识到这个行业的重要，以及这个行业也可能也是一个非常浪漫的专业。对啊，不要拿简单的为说是个非常艰苦的专业。现在我们在招生里面是设定为一种艰苦专业在招生的，所以我觉得这会带来问题。第二，我们现在招生的现状，在座的我们各位，也许我们用手机、用网络、用微信，我们顶多算得上数字化的移民，但是我们的下一代，在年轻的一些孩子们，他们是数字化的原住民。所以面对这些数字化的原住民，面对的生活条件的提高，如何使得这些孩子他能够选择这个专业，而且是优秀的人能够选择专业，能够有那种忠诚度，能够在船上能够享受他认为说可以享受的生活，这实际上面临的很大很大的挑战，值得我们这些搞教育的，我们在座的业内的这些先辈们、前辈们，大家共同来思考。所以如何把这个艰苦专业让它变成一个浪漫的专业啊，我觉得这是一个。那我一直想说，现在这些那个走船的跟我们这陆地的有什么最大的不同呢？我自己个人认为，可能他们有一些相对比较自由，所谓的自由是空闲的时间，但是呢又受到限制的这种时间，所以呢这些时间可能会比较孤独，也会比较寂寞。但是呢这里面有好处也有不好处，所以我觉得我刚才讲就是面对的我们是要育人， 刚才我们那个上海海事大学的那个校长说的那个，我很赞成。我们是要培养人，我们不是培养一种操作机器。
I know the time is up. But since the maritime education and training is the first time the topic that we share here, I'm very sorry to interrupt Professor Lee, but we have one more to share. It's Captain Pai from Myanmar. We understand that China and Myanmar recently signed an MOU on maritime education and training, witnessed by the Chinese and Myanmar president. With that, I would like to ask Captain Pai, as the founder and director of the largest private training institution in Yangon, what do you think the China-Myanmar MOU on maritime education and training should be focusing on? How would Myanmar Excellent Star contribute in sharpening the human capital in our maritime industry? Captain Pai, please.
Hi, Mikey. It is a very valid question. And let me start with a very, very quick review of the Myanmar reforming structure of the maritime education and training. Actually, the government's system has been reformed since 2011. And they started giving us a chance to open up a private training center. Before 2011, there were no private training centers in Myanmar. There are two government training institutions in Myanmar. But after 2011, there are many private training centers coming up. And we can attract many instructors as senior officers from the sea to come ashore as marine instructors. And secondly, in 2012, the government abolished the tax, 10% of tax from the seafarer wages. This is also the biggest attraction for all seafarers, especially for the young people want to go to sea a lot. Presently, there are 60,000 of Myanmar seafarers working as officers in the rating on both the international shipping lines, and also about 20,000 of young people are looking for a good opportunity to go to sea. And recently, last month, the Myanmar president has visited China, and they have signed some MOU regarding with the maritime education and training for the development of the seafarer. Actually, it is a very important milestone for the maritime education for both country. Especially, we have a very high expectation on this. Our expectations, our focusing, the MOU should focus in on the China have many ship owner, many ship operator, and Myanmar has many good people to sail with. So we like to promote Chinese ship owner and ship operator for the awareness of the development of the Myanmar maritime education and training. And also, we like to invite many Chinese ship owner and ship operator to come and establish and collaborate with the maritime education and training. And on the other hand, we like to have more opportunity to cooperate with many Chinese maritime education and training centers and Chinese maritime university. And also, we like to have some opportunity for upgrading our maritime instructors and especially the postgraduate program and to promote our capacity. And also, it is a very important milestone that Myanmar and China having a good relationship in terms of maritime. Myanmar is actually a maritime nation. As we all know, Myanmar seems to be like an out of the global community for decades, for some reasons. But Myanmar has the, respectful maritime history. And I would like to say that we are coming back. We are coming back with full potential. And also, I would like to say that, like the President Nelson Mandela say, education is the powerful weapon which we can change the world. So that I like to mention here, maritime education and training is the most powerful and environmental friendly engine to move the maritime industry toward a safer and sustainable development in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Captain. Before I end this session, I would like to invite all of you to join me to thanks to show our appreciation to the panelists. Applause. And of course, we cannot forget about the moderator.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.